trying to get out of Gent. Shouldn't be that difficult, it's already 11 in the morning. The weather definitely is turning, but it's still terrible. It's a bit cold. I mean, cold for me is 8 degrees Celsius in mid-April. So, yeah. A lot of people, that's just a normal part of life in April. We have arrived at a park and ride park, basically, here next to a subway station in the outskirts of Rotterdam. I think it's the most practical thing because I don't really like to drive here in the middle of all these lanes with all these lights. I mean, nothing wrong with it, I can do it. It's just I don't like it. It's a bit oppressive. So I'm just leaving the car here. I think it's a free park. We're gonna confirm it's free. And we're just going to see things. is we booked a certain room which was actually south of Rotterdam, so it would mean going back, but to a small distance. But we couldn't get to the guy. Airbnb assistants couldn't get to the guy, so they just cancelled it and gave us our money back. But we tried to book a room in North Holland, the province, within such short notice and for a reasonable price. And for me, a reasonable price is below 80 euros. And you'll find it really, really difficult. Actually, we didn't book through Airbnb this time. Breakfast that we booked through Booking, and it was a bit more expensive. It was 89, although it includes breakfast. It's 20 something more euros than we had already paid in the first place, although we got the money back. And there's a caveat, another caveat, which is it is north of Amsterdam. The way things are now, we'll probably just drive towards the nearest train station to the bed breakfast and go in the Sprinter, I'm not sure if it's the Sprinter Intercity, the train. And we'll take the train from that station to Amsterdam Central. That might be one way to do it, unless there is a nice park and ride facility somewhere north of Amsterdam. Yeah, we're gonna do it that way. This is what breaking the law in the Netherlands looks like when you are doing 115 on the motorway, and it's not 7.
Regarding to just pray that this able to at least one, test the oil pressure, or if not that, at least have a look at the sun, just to try and really convince myself that I did something to try and prevent some catastrophe. But even if a catastrophe happens and that would be the engine stopping or me having to stop it before it really goes boom, it wouldn't be so bad because we're already close to Amsterdam, simple. There are a couple small airports that work with Ryanair, for example, for us to get back home. So we're already thinking about that scenario. In case that happens, it wouldn't be terrible. The cost of these engines in Portugal is not that high. I mean, of course, I don't want to spend 350 euros or 400 plus fitting it. But if it comes to that, there are worse things in life. And if you think about the pain of booking different rooms here in order to accommodate the car being at a garage and the expense at the garage here, which is obviously higher than in Portugal, yeah, it really doesn't pay to be too safe, let's put it that way. Although I'm saying this, and I might regret it a lot in a couple miles. But with that being said, we're still driving to the specialist and seeing what they can do. Really not the best news. But that sort of thing happens, right? That's it. See you in a moment, because I need to turn somewhere here.
The Dutch don't hang around, that's for sure. In 3 minutes we'll be at Almere station and we're gonna get on the train and go to Amsterdam again. So that's why I'm only filming this short video until later this afternoon. And I'm gonna explain to you how we finally solved the oil warning message. Because as you can see, there are no more beeps. We go around corners, and the solution is so simple, I'm actually ashamed.
Hello everyone, I don't know if you can see it, but we've already been city. So if the weather is a bit better, we might have a walk around and see if it's really worth it. Tomorrow morning we'll probably go to Utrecht, and then we have to go to Amsterdam again because we booked tickets to the Rijksmuseum for the wrong day. We're using the car a bit for our travels between Airbnbs, places where we sleep, and the park and ride facilities. Today we went to Almere and left the car there, Almere Balta. And tomorrow I'm not entirely sure what I will do, because as much as the park and ride today was cheap in terms of parking, 2 euros for the entire day, the ticket for both of us to go and to come back was 35 euros, which is very expensive for, let me see, 65-70 kilometer round trip. If you can find parking that is not obscene closer to Amsterdam, maybe to the metro line or something, that would be possible. Now, you might have noticed that there are no beeps this time. I already told you this morning. Basically, yesterday morning, as we were leaving our accommodations, when I turned the engine on, the warning immediately came on that the level was low. Actually, that the engine oil pressure was low. Of course, because while the engine is cold, the oil is not as fluid, and there was no oil in it. So that makes sense. But at the time, I didn't know that this wasn't just a misreading. But I started feeling that, and I felt that there was a little bit more clatter from the bulbs than usual. Nothing absolutely terrifying, but definitely a sign, given that I already had this warning. So I panicked a little bit and went to a garage, just a regular garage near, with the light flashing in all corners, and all the time I was braking. And the guy at the garage just took my word for it that the oil level was okay, that it was actually above maximum. And he told me that, yeah, there was a little bit of clatter. He couldn't do anything that Friday because he had a lot of work yet to complete. Yeah, he was saying that it could be something in the engine, maybe we could remove the sump and see if something was there, but it could be the oil pump. You know, immediately going for the worst case scenario, let's put it that way. And given what I told him, okay, I can't really judge him, but he didn't actually see the dipstick, even after I told him that I had difficulties reading it. So you might see where this is getting, especially if you know these cars. The next thing I did was what I had actually decided the night before, which would be to take this car to a specialist near Amsterdam, in Eben, which is Johan Oldenhagen. I think that's how you pronounce it. I'm really sorry if it's not. It's near Amsterdam, it would suit us to leave the car there if something would need to be done during the day, if they had time. We've been really well received and taken care of. And basically the first thing that they've done was check the oil level on the dipstick. And let's start with the basics, right? And of course, there is a trick to the dipstick. You look at the front and it's all smudged in oil. That's why I always got the impression that it would dribble even after you cleared it. Nice. Some people looking at the car in a new bulb. And the back would be clear. And that's the bad part. When the back is clear, that means you have no oil. You actually read the oil on the back of the lipstick, between the two little dents, the two little marks that you have there. So there was really little oil in the engine. I think he told me that he actually added something like 2 liters and something to the engine, which is just incredible. How on earth was the car still running without making terrible noises and just showing that all the time? Of course it started slowly, just flickering on some corners, but the last miles I was really careful around corners and braking in order to keep the car as level as possible, and that might have helped, of course, but imagine what it is to have done hundreds of miles with the light occasionally flickering, because I don't know if other engines would take this sort of abuse. Of course, I'm guilty for not having learned to read the dipstick. properly at home where I needed to. But I've only owned this car for 2 months. And to be honest, the first garage where I took it in Poitiers, near Poitiers, they thought it was over maximum because they read the wrong side of the dipstick. So it's not as easy as it seems. It's not as stupid as it seems at first. And this is not the first car that I own. I can assure you, I've read many dipsticks before. Weird sentence, but let's ignore that. So yeah, I took it for a test drive after filling with oil. And basically the test drive consisted of getting off sprightly, then turning aggressively, then braking, and nothing. No more flickering, no more warnings, everything as it should. So, thank you to Johan Odenach for sorting the issue. A simple issue it turned out to be, but it could have been bad, very bad. And with that being said, the issues that I've had with this car during this trip were really more due to external factors, like the tire, or me not, and the garage not being able to read the dipstick, than the car itself. Yes, this window is starting to play up. It seems to want to be stuck at certain points, so the cable might just tear at some point. And the button that controls the regulation for the back of the seat, passenger seat, didn't want to go up again. So we replaced it with this button here to put it back in its place. It has worked after that, but in general, doing really well. Really can't fault it. There are some other impressions that have changed a little bit about this car during this trip, but I'll leave that for later because now I need to go where I'm going. So, stay tuned.
Leaving to Amstelveen, getting out of here shouldn't be too difficult. There's a lot of movement. It's Sunday morning. Even if it's Sunday morning, buses are working well. We didn't have to wait much for them at all. For any of them, in fact. You can just pay with your debit card, which is good. And you can follow whatever GoMax is telling you because it's actually accurate. More accurate than what you have at the bus stop, would you believe it? It's a charming city, although maybe a little less than Amsterdam. But it's more friendly if you don't like a lot of crowds and stuff.